He's just a redneck, plain and simple.
It was Karl saying, hey, I am different. This is the way I run my life.
It was a little ballet show going on out here, but with power and grace.
Stockton, the Malone, the Mailman, hammered up.
You tell Karl he's great, and you can start to see the pressure weigh on him. You tell Karl he's nothing, and he will destroy you.
Karl Malone was this close to a championship, and Michael Jordan took it away from him.
I had issues when I was growing up. I had issues because my dad wasn't around.
I know you're not supposed to hate people, but I just hated him.
I'm so sorry about the years we wasted.
Used to be, the power forward was a guy who just was a defender and a rebounder. And Karl made it more fashionable to score.
To the Mailman, to the hoop, into a fake bomber. Karl Malone with a hammer.
Strong as he was on the block, he was also able to step out and make people play him on the outside and hit jumpers and run the floor like no other power forward has run the floor.
I felt I could throw the ball at any time as hard as I wanted to, and he didn't even have to be lucky. As long as he looked up before the ball hit his hands, he would catch it.
With a rare combination of strength, touch, size, and agility, Karl Malone was the ultimate power forward. Over 19 NBA seasons, he never missed the playoffs and starred at both ends of the court, ranking second all-time in career points and sixth in rebounds. Selected first-team All-NBA for 11 straight seasons, he was twice voted the league's most valuable player.
He had the power, but he had the skill to go along with it. And he had the nastiness to be able to apply all of that on the court. He didn't care. He wanted to win, whether around you, through you, or whatever it took.
I hate Karl Malone. And when I say I hate Karl Malone, I mean it in a good way. It's just so hard to defend him.
He was nice to me when I was on the Dream Team. But if I was checking him in a game, he'd try to put his elbow through my mouth.
David Robinson goes down immediately. It looked like a Karl Malone elbow.
I thought he was a little cheap. I thought he took cheap shots. I thought he did things that he didn't have to do. Most of the stuff would happen against smaller guys or guys that weren't going to fight back.
Out he goes, Isaiah. Chuck Daly's going crazy. Isaiah Thomas hurt badly.
A lot of the people in Detroit thought it was a cheap shot, it was a cheap blow, you know, but that's the way Karl Malone played. He played tough. He took no prisoner.
I don't look at him as a dirty player or a cheap shot player. I just look at him as a physical player.
Karl dished it out, and Karl got it. I would see him peel off his shirt after games and see scratch marks across his chest that had drawn blood. I saw his ankle knotted up so it looked like the root of a tree.
If Malone sometimes hurt opposing players, the 6'9", 256-pounder also absorbed their constant assaults. In his 18 seasons with Utah, he missed just six games because of illness or injury.
This middle finger off his shooting hand, he tore the tendon but refused to have surgery, so he just taped it. Then he took it off one time and it would just flop around. He just came to work, and that's the bottom line. He was tough, he was rugged. He liked the challenge. He wanted someone to try to stop him.
When you talk about Karl Malone, the first thing you have to talk about is his work ethic. Karl Malone was in the weight room in the off season at 6:30 in the morning.
He's extremely obsessive. You could mess with him a little bit, you know. I mean, he could be so gullible sometimes, you know. I'd say, hey, you know, Karl, I read like we're... Alonzo Mourning's like doing this and this and this, you know, I didn't rather making it up, and he'd go for it, you know, so he'd like push him a little harder.
He felt that if he wasn't at the top shape, he wasn't going to be able to provide for his team and the image that he has to live up to being the mailman that delivers all the time.
Karl Malone never took a playoff, and it didn't matter whether it was an NBA Finals game or whether it was garbage time, middle of March. Karl Malone was running the floor like it was the last time he was ever going to run the floor.
Karl Malone had this persona that's larger than life. He embraces the truck driving, he embraces the country ways, he loves the manly approach to life. He is a person who was as big as the Western skyscape, and he was a perfect fit for that Utah culture.
Malone stars in the movie Rockwell, a biographical action film about Porter Rockwell, a gunfighter who became a deputy marshal in the Utah Territory.
I think he got away.
I'll get him. I'll take care of Willie.
Sure.
Go on.
We used to go out together, and he had those cowboy boots on and cowboy hat, and I'm like, man, this is not what the NBA is all about.
He's just a redneck, plain and simple. He'd always call me to go hunt, and I said, what you going hunting for? He's like, mountain lion and black bear. I'm like, what about squirrel and deer, something like that?
He's not just the regular NBA player, and I think Karl liked that and relished that and made that a big deal, too. It was Karl saying, hey, I am different, and this is the way I run my life.
The fact of the matter is, if you got the AIDS virus, it'll be hard for me to play as hard as I'm capable of playing. Maybe I'm saying something that other people wouldn't say. And if people can't respect my decision, that's tough.
Karl Malone was his own guy. And that didn't wash with some of the black community. When he wore an FBI hat, Spike Lee sent him a letter saying, do you know what the FBI did to our people long ago? Karl Malone wrote him back and said, I want to wear this hat. It means something to me, and I don't care.
As much as Karl said, I don't care, Karl did care, and that's why he had so many mood swings.
When you do something nice that never get talked about, which is Karl Malone wants, Karl Malone greed, Karl Malone this, I'm sick of him and all that, well, I'm sick too.
Probably as sensitive to criticism as any player that I've ever observed. Anything that fans would yell, anything that the media would write.
There were times when John and I said, yeah, you know, you see what that guy said in the paper about you? He's going, what? He said he could stop you from scoring 20 points. Carl would go out there and score 45.
Like a method actor uses emotional insecurity to enhance his performance, so did Malone use criticism to energize his game, even at the free throw line.
He said he was cursing the media, he was cursing his critics, he was talking about somebody in the stands that had said something about him. He thought he played better when he was mad at somebody.
AC Green was a starter in the All-Star game. It's announced. It was not an accident that Malone went out and got his career high against Milwaukee and dropped 61 on him. And that was not an accident.
Malone takes a 20-footer. The Mailman is incredible.
Karl often felt a need to be recognized. He did the things that he needed to do to be recognized, but playing in a small market like Salt Lake, I think he felt like he always wasn't on the receiving end of what he should have been.
You tell Karl he's great, and you could start to see the pressure weigh on him. You tell Karl he's nothing, and he will destroy you.
Yeehaw.
He said that I'll never forget where I'm from. I've always loved Summerfield, Louisiana. I've always loved Louisiana. This is where I'm going to retire one day, and this is where I'm going to live.
It's just a small town with 5 or 6 churches, one store, one post office, and one school.
You can think of dinner on the grounds and cold leftover chicken on a pink saucer on somebody's oven and doors unlocked. Everybody knows everybody's name. Everybody knows everybody's dog's name.
Born on July 24, 1963, in Summerfield, Louisiana, Karl was the youngest boy of Shirley Malone's 9 children. She worked multiple jobs to keep her family fed and clothed.
My mom, she really raised us by herself. Sometimes she'd work at the sawmill, and then she'd work at houses. Most of the time we wouldn't see her. We would all write little notes for her, you know, and put it on the stove. Say, we love you, you know, hope you get some rest. Just write little love notes to her.
Karl was crazy about her, and he never let that go unsaid if somebody brought up the subject of his mom.
Karl has a tremendous work ethic, and he got it from his upbringing. With his mom and his brothers and his sisters, they pretty much carried their own weight around that place.
He hauled hay for 2 or 3 years in the summer. And Karl leave early, early in the morning before day, and wouldn't get back until it's dark again.
Shirley was firm, fair, and consistent. She believed in you. You play hard and you work hard, and their big together time was fishing.
She loved her family. She did not expect anyone to take care of her family but herself.
While his mother labored round the clock, Karl's father, Shedrick Hay, was living with his wife and raising another family.
He didn't live that far away from us, but I can never even remember hugging him. I don't even remember touching him. We didn't really grow up with him. You know, he never was in our life no more than when just passing.
If Malone's father was absent, his mother somehow found the time to encourage him in a summer field tradition.
You do not pass a house that has children that there's not a basketball goal in the yard. Usually an old utility pole, a piece of plywood as a backboard, and a rim that's been bent and put back together many times. And games would rotate from one driveway to the next.
He was probably fourth or fifth grade. She put the basketball on layaway at this little store, and she would pay, you know, 50 cents, you know, a dollar, whatever she could until she paid it out. We didn't never have a real basketball goal. She would, you know, hold on arms out like this, and he would shoot through it.
At Summerfield High School, Malone led the Rebels to 3 straight Class C state championships.
Big high schools or little high schools, you didn't see 6'7" bulky people that could run like a deer. And that was the first thing that you could see about it.
A raw, just physically dominating player. If we got the ball to Karl in the lane, you know, we could pretty much head down the other way because he was going to go to the hole with it. He was going to put it in. He was going to get his own rebound.
He became probably as well known for his shot blocking as he did his incredible rebounding and his scoring.
We had colleges from everywhere coming to see him play and call in. They called here constantly.
It was going to probably boil down to who was the closest to his mama. And if it would have been a school in between Tech and Summerfield, we'd have lost out.
After committing to Louisiana Tech in the spring of 1981, Malone learned that his grade point average was too low to play Division I basketball. So he took out a loan to pay for his first year of college and focused on improving his grades and his game.
Karl said it was the best thing could have happened to him. He got it in and, you know, got his grades.
There was such a metamorphosis in him from his senior year of high school to his sophomore year of college. We had a brand new intramural sports complex on campus, and Karl lived there, making basketball his career.
I believe the year that he set out increased his hunger for the game. He was so happy and excited to be out there. I mean, he brought a lot of energy.
Nice pass from Smith to Malone.
A 3-time All-Southland Conference first-team selection, Malone led the Bulldogs to the NCAA tournament in 1984 and 1985. Averaging 19 points and 9 rebounds over 3 seasons, Malone was given a nickname that aptly described his consistency on the court.
That started being the headlines. Mailman delivers another victory. Can the Mailman deliver a conference title?
He got hyped as this, almost as this incredible Hulk that nobody can stop. That's what's amazing about it, that he didn't have knockout statistics in college. It was more of that mailman, that toughness, hey, I can knock this guy out, don't get in my way.
Just a beast to stop. And they just pounded it inside to him. And he was just so much stronger than the big guys that we had.
Some would say that he was a little bit too aggressive. But I think every night that he set foot on the floor, it was a challenge to him, you know, to prove that he was one of the better players in the NCAA.
In fact, Malone had reason to look beyond the NCAA.
A lot of these pre-draft list were rating him high. Also, the monetary part where he could help his mom. He was ready to go. He was ready for the next level.
In the spring of 1985, Karl Malone was so certain that the Mavericks were going to select him with the eighth pick of the NBA draft that he rented an apartment in Dallas.
The Dallas Mavericks select Detlef Schrempf of the University of Washington.
For our good fortune, he was there when we picked the 13th, and we didn't hesitate.
He thinks that he was disrespected coming out of college. He really thought that he was going to go higher in the draft than he did. And I think from that point on, he played with the chip on his shoulder. He felt like he had something to prove.
What we saw was the rawness, this talent. Our relationship became close to a father-son relationship, but I was the father. I had to remind him that a lot of times.
It was so important to him to have a father who he could relate to while he was growing up, but he never had. Frank recognized early on that Karl really had this dearth of male guidance in his life, father figure, if you will. And I think he really put his arm around Karl, figuratively and sometimes literally.
I said to him, Karl, you know, you're so talented. I mean, you get a seat in the Hall of Fame if you want it. He went home that summer. When he came back, there was a new determination. And we put Karl Malone down in the box where he stayed for the next 19 years. We never had a losing season again.
Malone really is an incredible shooter. You go back to his rookie year, he could not make a 15-footer, right? The evolution of Karl Malone has been remarkable.
He became a very good passer. He could hit the outside shot. He picked up a little bit of a hook shot moving across the lane. It seemed he would come back every year and have one more weapon in his arsenal.
In 1988, the benevolent Frank Layden was replaced by Jerry Sloan, a tough taskmaster short on compliments and long on commitment. Yet he and his highly sensitive forward found common ground.
I lost my father at an early age and came from a large family. He kind of grew up on a farm, and I kind of grew up on a farm, and there was a little relationship there, maybe.
Jerry Sloan is this hard-driven, just brutally honest, demanding, so hard to earn respect from. Jerry Sloan's ideal is that basketball's not hard. You simply go out on the floor every night and you lay your heart on the line. Karl Malone is one of those rare, rare people who could live up to the Jerry Sloan ideal.
As Malone improved, so did the fortunes of the Jazz, a team that had been teetering financially since the franchise moved to Salt Lake City from New Orleans in 1979. Owner Larry Miller drew close to his rising star.
Larry Miller did give him a lot of advice. Karl had enough respect for Larry Miller that it took him probably 10 years before he even would use an agent to negotiate his contracts.
Two people from completely opposite ends of the spectrum managed to entwine themselves into a relationship that is so close this day that maybe there's no other like it in professional sports. And people who you love, you often fight with. And Karl and Larry were no different in that regard.
I have played my last game in Salt Lake City, and it's time for Karl to move on because I think damage has been done.
I have been asked, can the relationship with Karl and the Jazz ever be the same? And quite honestly, I've responded, most of the time, I don't know, and sometimes I don't think so.
Every year, Larry would get mad, and Karl would get mad, and they would have a fight, and then they would break up.
I'm not going to get on this TV and plead to him, oh, God, take me back. No, I'm not divorced. You know what I'm saying? It's just the marriage is a little rocky.
That was one way he motivated himself to get ready to play the season and go out there and say, okay, now I've stuck my foot in my mouth a little bit. Now what am I going to do about it?
I've got to go play.
But if Malone and Miller had been posturing before the season, what occurred during Game 5 of the 1994 Western Conference Semifinals was as real as a right cross to the chin.
Malone tries again, and again he is off the mark.
From the very beginning, something was wrong with Karl. I mean, to be in that big a game, and he wasn't playing like he normally did. He wasn't contesting rebounds.
Just before halftime, an agitated Miller approached the Jazz bench.
And then the bark came. Get him off the floor.
And Jerry looked up at him, you know.
Get him off the floor. No one thought ever would Larry turn on Karl Malone.
It's uncharacteristic for him to say that, but if he said it, not to surprise me in this business.
I acted like, you know, like a horse's behind, and it was an emotional thing where I did something foolish and immature, but it really cut Karl deeply. He said, you know, I grew up without a dad, and I put you, maybe unfairly, too much in that role where I was too emotionally dependent on your acceptance of me. And then that night, you pulled the rug out from under me.
After a tearful reconciliation with Miller, Malone shared a secret on TV that he had held since he was 14.
He told the city that his dad had taken his own life. And there was just silence and tears. The disappointment of his father taking his own life and leaving a family behind, unacceptable in his mind.
There were more secrets from Malone's past yet to surface.
I know you're not supposed to hate people, but I just hated him because we didn't ask to be here, and we're here, and he didn't want to have nothing to do with us.
Goes out and does things anonymously. Walks into a house of a family that has a sick child and rips up their mortgage.
Our insurance had dropped us unilaterally, and Karl came to our rescue.
I saw him walk over by the locker room one night, and there was a kid with a terminal illness in a wheelchair, and I saw Karl kneel in front of him with tears running down his face, and I saw him pull off the jersey right there and hand it to the kid.
Karl Malone and his wife Kay, a former Miss Idaho, were active in several charities and ran their own foundation for the benefit of needy children. Into their lodge-style home, perched high above the Salt Lake Valley, the Malones welcomed four children of their own.
Which way? Huh? Okay. Daddy following you. The grass gonna be taller than you are, you know that?
At that point, Karl was basically a legend in Salt Lake City. Certainly, he had established himself as a premier first ballot Hall of Famer. He had this family and fit in great with the community in Salt Lake City, which is predominantly a family community. It's what it's known for.
But in 1998, a national tabloid story challenged Malone's wholesome image by detailing two paternity lawsuits that had been filed against Malone back home in Louisiana during the 1980s. Weeks after Malone graduated from high school in 1981, his former girlfriend, Benita Ford, gave birth to twins, Daryl and Cheryl.
I'm 17. I'm walking around with my chest stuck out. And said to yourself, hey, look at me. I got twins. And then to visit them and she say they're not yours, you know, yeah, it crushes you.
They didn't really know that he was their father, so I just, you know, I thought maybe we could get through life without telling them, you know.
Then in 1984, during Malone's sophomore season at Louisiana Tech, 13-year-old Gloria Bell gave birth to a boy, Demetrius. She identified the father as Karl Malone.
So then, I confronted Cole. He didn't want to talk too much on it. So I decided I'd get me a lawyer.
In In 1986, the child's grandparents, Tommy and Ola Mae Bell, filed suit against Malone seeking child support on behalf of their daughter, who was a minor. A blood test set the probability that Malone was the father at 99.3%. The case was settled out of court. Then, in 1989, a similar suit was filed by Benita Ford, the mother of the twins.
And then, as much hurt as you had, that they were said they were not yours, to now they're yours because you NBA superstar, it do piss you off.
In September of 1992, the court found Malone in contempt for refusing to reveal his assets and not submitting to DNA testing in the Ford case. Soon after, the lawyers negotiated another out-of-court settlement. Meanwhile, all three children were growing up, knowing Malone only as a distant figure.
I know you're not supposed to hate people, but I just hated him because, I mean, we didn't ask to be here. And we're here, and he didn't want to have nothing to do with us.
What really got me, one day I was walking to class, and a guy come up to me. I'll never forget, he said, "How does it feel that your daddy making millions and you down here with practically nothing?" And there wasn't nothing you could say.
Six years after the suit was settled, and shortly after the story came out in 1998, Malone met the Ford twins for the first time, appearing unannounced back in Louisiana.
I was in shock. Like, is this really happening? And I'm like wondering why did it take you this long?
We just started talking, and instantly we started bonding right there, believe it or not. Just because everything he liked, I liked. You know, everything he liked doing, I liked doing.
I'm so sorry about the years we wasted. But I don't dwell in the past because we're wasting time. I made a mistake. I'm a man to own up to my mistakes, and we move on.
Both Daryl and Cheryl went on to play basketball at Malone's alma mater, Louisiana Tech. Cheryl became a star and in 2003 was drafted third overall by the Detroit Shock.
He's very committed to Cheryl and Daryl. Is it a perfect relationship? No. But is it a relationship built on somebody who had matured along the way, coming to a realization that maybe mistakes were made along the way? Absolutely.
I wasn't there. So I give Rita 100% of that credit on making them into the kids that they are right now. And I don't mind doing that. I had issues when I was growing up. I had issues because my dad wasn't around. I wish my dad would have been there for my first basketball game. I wish my dad would have been there for my first hunting trip, my first big fish I caught.
He clearly, you know, has said he understands the impact you can have when your father's not there. But at the same time, these twins live 17 years without it.
Like the Ford twins, Demetrius Bell went on to play college basketball at Northwestern State in Louisiana. But unlike the twins, Bell has not been recognized by Malone as his son.
I think if he knew he growed up without a dad, he knew how he suffered. He should have wanted to be taking care of his. He knew it was his. You shouldn't want your child to go through what you went through.
Little short white dude with these tight booty shorts on, and then you got Karl Malone, this big brawny country black dude.
On the alley-oop from Stockton to Malone. Stockton to Malone. Gets it. Gotta know they're going pick and roll.
Stockton and Malone ran the pick and roll better than any two people who've ever played the game. They could watch how you were gonna defend it and then adjust on the fly.
It was a little ballet show going on out there, but with power and grace.
Stockton to Malone, my goodness, I'll have a headache for a month.
Haven't I just seen that play? Yes, every NBA team saw it over and over and over again, and nobody could stop it.
It's like, you peanut butter, I'm jam. To me, that might have been the best 1-2 punch that ever played the game.
Although the textbook symbiosis of Karl Malone and John Stockton propelled the Jazz into the playoffs every year between 1986 and 1996, it was not enough to get them into the NBA Finals, as they fell three times in the Western Conference Finals. As the years passed, their frustration grew.
4-1. Houston wins the West.
Jerry Sloan, John Stockton, and Karl Malone were the three scariest guys I ever saw. Because they were just haunted by, you know, how badly they wanted to win.
In reality, their team wasn't good enough. The Jazz had two great players. They didn't have enough other parts.
I'm trying. We're trying. Why are we trying and everybody else doing? Give me the manpower to be playing in June.
Every time his season would end short, you know, he was back in the gym the next day, just driven for the next season. He kept expecting that final piece to come, you know, if it's Jeff Hornacek or Ostertag or Brian Russell. He believed in the franchise. He believed they would find him the missing pieces to get them to the finals, and they eventually did.
Uh-oh. Stockton, open three. John Stockton sends the Utah Jazz to the NBA Finals.
In 1997, the Jazz finally arrived within sight of the NBA championship, but an implacable force stood in the way.
They get up to the top, and there's the one guy who will never let you beat him.
Well, that was a guy called Michael Jordan. Michael Jordan. It's Superman.
There's Jordan. Than everybody else, and they just can't get there in time.
George putting moves on Russell. We're down to two, down to one. Here's Jordan.
That was the time that we saw there's a difference between a Jordan and Malone.
I don't have any excuses, and I'm not going to use any. To me, it was embarrassing. You know, it was embarrassing the way I played, and I try to correct that, and I'll be the first to admit that.
Although Malone, who had been voted league MVP, averaged 24 points and 10 rebounds, the Jazz could not overcome the explosive talent of Michael Jordan's Bulls.
It's over. Chicago's won it. Over. 5 titles in 7 years.
The next season, the Jazz again met the Bulls in the finals.
The first year, we felt that the Bulls were a better team. It was our first year getting there. The second year, we felt we were the better team.
This time, they will get Michael. This time, Michael cannot beat Malone.
Stockton closed the door for Utah in overtime and goes up on Chicago in game one.
Up 1-0, the Jazz had reason to believe they could beat the Bulls.
They had home court advantage. They thought they had the Bulls figured out, but it wasn't motivating. It wasn't edgy. He's always been better in an underdog role because that's the role he played for so long.
The Jazz dropped the next three games, including a humiliating 96-54 defeat in Game 3.
It was, in the NBA Finals by the Utah Jazz, the lowest point total in any NBA game up until that time since the advent of the 24-second clock. I mean, you cannot sink to a lower depth than that.
I think he was so angry. Nobody was playing for pride. He thought, I'm not going out like this. One thing he has is a tremendous amount of pride.
In Game 5 in Chicago, Malone applied the full measure of his talent.
Malone. He continues to carry the Utah Jazz as they try to stave off elimination.
A must-win game. The balloons are up on the ceiling. The champagne is on ice. And he's going to take the series back to Salt Lake City. And that's what he did with a 39-point performance.
They smell the blood. They're going for it. For him to have a game and us win that game was unbelievable.
Back home in the Delta Center, the Jazz fought to even the series in Game 6. Up by a point with less than 25 seconds to go, Stockton hit Malone with a pass in the low post.
We had a lead in our own building. The ball came into Karl's hands, and my immediate thought was, we've won the game.
I was guarding Malone, and Malone turned his back.
He was looking one way, and as he got ready to do his move, MJ was right there.
I talked to a Jazz fan later who was at the game, and he said, "It was a horrible moment. I could see him, and I'm like, in a movie, and I'm like, he's right behind you." He says, "I couldn't get it out. I couldn't warn him."
Jordan knocks it away from him. Jordan got it. The ball can win it right here. Unbelievable.
And there's Karl sprawled out on the floor, this big monster of a man, while Jordan's got the ball dribbling down the court to break 19,000 hearts.
Jordan, open, Chicago with the lead!
Behind the backboard, you can see people doing it. Like, they knew it. There's nothing they can say. It was like, Karl Malone screwed up.
The Chicago Bulls have won their sixth NBA championship.
Karl Malone was this close to a championship. He could taste it, he could feel it, and Michael Jordan took it away from him.
I just remember Malone just being very stoic in defeat. Winning a championship was obviously very important to him, but we just never saw the pain.
What do you take away from losing in the finals?
This losing in the finals sucks. That's what I take away for this summer.
I never sensed Karl shrinking from the challenge. Sometimes he came through and sometimes he didn't. Nobody came through as consistently and as often in big NBA games in that era as Jordan did. So it's not necessarily a disgrace to be the runner-up to him.
Karl Malone had left his sanctuary in Utah for this great opportunity. Midway through the season, he was looking at reporters and asking them, "What did I get myself into?"
Seconds away, Cheryl Ford at the foul line. And the mailman can't even bear to watch.
In September of 2003, the Detroit Shock won the WNBA championship. Making four clutch free throws in the deciding game's final minute was rookie Cheryl Ford, the daughter from whom Karl Malone had been estranged for her first 17 years.
She ran up to him, hugged him, and said, "I got my ring before you got yours."
Just 2 months before, the quest for his own championship ring led free agent Malone to make a move late in his career.
John Stockton was gone. Karl Malone probably would have been in the way of this team trying to rebuild.
He had two choices, basically. He could have gone after the Kareem Abdul-Jabbar scoring championship and been the league's all-time leading scorer. He could have stayed in Utah and done that. Or he could have said, "You know what, I'll give up that record and go win a championship in L.A.
You know how Shaquille put his spin on it. He said, "You come to L.A., we rule the world."
In July of 2003, just 9 days before his 40th birthday, Malone signed with the Lakers. For the upcoming season, he would receive $1.5 million, almost $18 million less than his salary the previous campaign with the Jazz. But with Shaquille O'Neal, Kobe Bryant, Gary Payton, and Phil Jackson, he could almost feel that championship ring on his finger.
I was happy for him because I thought it was the right time. I didn't think he was in a position to carry our team like he had, and I didn't think it was fair.
I don't think in a million years that he envisioned stepping into the three-ring circus that it evolved into.
Kobe Bryant was charged with one count of third-degree sexual assault against a 19-year-old Colorado woman.
3 days after Malone signed with the Lakers, Bryant was charged with sexual assault, setting off a media frenzy that would distract the team for an entire season. Then, in August, Malone's 64-year-old mother, Shirley, was fatally stricken with a heart attack.
Karl was profoundly affected by the death of his mother, in large part because it was so unexpected, in large part because of the obvious role that Miss Shirley played in Karl's life.
When Shirley passed away, Karl, I think some of that drive and the desire to play for her went with it.
In October, the Lakers launched their campaign as a team deeply divided.
Well, Shaquille O'Neal and Kobe Bryant stopped fighting long enough to get a game in tonight. Karl Malone had left his sanctuary in Utah for this great opportunity. Midway through the season, he was looking at reporters and asking them, what did I get myself into?
Kobe and Shaq were obviously at each other's throats, but Karl served as that buffer. And so he became the leader, the elder statesman of that team, because everybody had a great deal of respect for him.
On the court, he taught Shaq and Kobe more about being tough, about playing through pain, about playing through distractions. Karl Malone did all that, but in the end, his body wouldn't hold up.
To the floor, he and Scott, Karl Malone immediately holding his right knee.
Guy hasn't had an injury of any substance for years and years, two decades, and all of a sudden he's out.
When Malone's sprained knee kept him from playing on December 23rd, it was only the seventh NBA game he'd ever missed because of illness or injury. He would remain sidelined for the next 39 games.
Once he got hurt, it's like, the heart and soul just left the building.
That was frustrating for him. I talked to him during this time, and he wasn't second-guessing the doctors. I think he was second-guessing himself a little bit. He's thinking, geez, you know, maybe I'm not as tough as I thought I was.
Malone returned in March to help the Lakers down the stretch, then through a dramatic playoff run. But in Game 3 of the NBA Finals against Detroit, Malone left the floor after 18 minutes.
When Karl went out, he took their interior defense with him. He took their defensive rebounding with him.
The Detroit Pistons, the champion of the National Basketball Association.
Now he doesn't have the scoring championship or the NBA championship, and so I think there's definitely a big void in his career.
I took a deep breath 30 years ago when I started playing ball when I was 11 years old. And now I'm able to just blow it out. That's how I feel today.
On February 13th, 2005, Malone officially retired. With almost 15,000 rebounds and 36,928 points, the Mailman had delivered his last slam for the NBA. Although the announcement was not unexpected, the timing had special significance. It was his mother's birthday.
I have retired. You will not see me play again. That is a promise.
I think Karl Malone's legacy is of a player who was there for his team. There's been nobody in the history of professional team sports who's carried a franchise like he has for as long as he has. Nobody.
Even though he didn't get his ring, everyone knows he's a great player. Some will consider him the best power forward of all time. His place in history is set.
Since retiring, Malone has moved his family from the trendy environs of Newport Beach, California, to a place near his hometown in Louisiana, where his idea of relaxation is clearing land with equipment from his own timber company.
Sort of back to his roots, it makes perfect sense. I never saw him in Newport Beach. Riding bikes on the Strand? That image just didn't work for me. Karl chopping down trees works for me.
When he gets out of the log truck, he's gonna be wearing cowboy gear, cowboy hat, have a stubble beard, just out in the woods, and he's having a great time. He loves doing this.
That's why I said he was a redneck. That's typical Karl Malone.